elektrisches Simulation.
Sorry, Winfried, do you mind if we record your talk?
Ja, okay. Mhm.
All right, recording has begun.
Electrical stimulation, as we know it widely, is always nerve stimulation, muscle stimulation, direct muscle stimulation, FS of denervated muscle is only occurring, only possible when the nerve is absent. This is a frequent misunderstanding also among the professional community. So. Yeah, when the nerve is absent, then we have a quite fast degeneration, first atrophy and then degeneration of all these nice structures. So we have started with this picture again. Already in the first year, we have atrophy with more connective tissue, smaller fibers and so on. But then in the second year, we also face a degeneration of the interior structures of the muscle cell and of these organelles with the so-called triads, the contraction excitation coupling. And then if it comes to 4 years after the innervation, we see that very little is left of the muscle tissue. It's substituted by other passive tissue components. A few healthy big fibers are there, but most of them are very tiny and degenerated. And when we go towards 10 years, we see that macroscopically and microscopically, there is really little left that can function. A very important point as we deal with electricity is muscle fiber conduction velocity of the muscle fibers. And this is for healthy muscle in the range of 4 to 5 meters per second. Within 10 months, it gets half of it, and within about 30 months, it gets a quarter of it. I come to this later. We had some work on denervated muscles in on larynx in sheep model, and then with Helmut Kern in his facility, with different devices we developed on patients with flaccid paraplegia. And we see here a very long-standing case, 30 years denervated, nearly no reaction. At the beginning, no reaction, and then after some months, a very slow and creeping and weak reaction, so at least something. This was 10 years denervation and then 1 year of training, so we see some basic functionality, but far from usable. And this gentleman here is about 5 years after denervation, has strong contractions and can move around quite nicely and endurant. So after a lot of drawbacks.
Question about that? For you to recover some function 30 years out or 10 years out, I would imagine there must be a little bit of residual innervation, just maybe a few fibers that require some hypertrophy.
Yeah, not really, because we test this with short impulses that are capable of activating nerves, but not muscles. And yeah. What you see here is with very large, long impulses. Okay. And initially we saw nothing, and then after just applying it for some time, some of the residual fibers, I guess there's some recovery in the muscle from time to time, that muscle fibers get built from stem cells, from satellite cells, due to tension activities, and maybe this is a basis for something, but very little.
So you would say there's essentially no time window. You can do it 1 year, 4 years, 10 years, 30 years, and still
I will show you examples. So the best is when you begin within the first year or in the first half year, they have the best results. We saw this in each parameter. Later on, you can also accomplish something, but the longer you wait, the more difficult it gets. And also the limit, more limited the result is. Yeah, so at this stage, we had somehow a kind of proof of principle after many drawbacks, but then we asked a group of colleagues at the Vienna international FES workshop to join us, and then we applied for a huge European project for the model of complete denervation of the lower extremities, flaccid paraplegia, and had quite some work on this. So these are the 20 partners. You see biomedical engineering is involved, neurology, dermatology, rehab clinics, muscle specialists, animal facilities. So a lot, and I cannot go into details, but we had a study on rabbits and a study on pigs here, and a lot of technical stuff to be developed for response assessment and stimulation, because nothing was on the market yet. But the heart was a study of 20 subjects out of screening of about 120. So it's not so easy to find complete paralysis at this level. And just through some of the data, this is a follow-up of the knee extension torque isometrically measured from patients with different denervation times initially in red. So we have early ones and also late ones. And you see there's very little torque development even in the short cases. But then 2 years later, you see the shift of the curve to two. There it is again confirmed. The early cases gain a lot and the late cases still gain something, but a lot less. Then we come to and then some resolution of tissue components by Hounsfield unit and artificial coloring. We see on the left row always the initial values and then the result after 2 years of stimulation. And we see in this fresh case, we have an excellent result after 2 years. When the denervation, the initial denervation was longer, it got worse and worse, but there was also always something accomplished. And in the long-term case, nearly no muscle in the cross-section, and still a lot was accomplished in 2 years. So this is a very untypical case. We wouldn't expect after 3.2 years a muscle that has still some muscle, normal muscle content, and that reacts so quickly to stimulation. But this was a special case of a professional athlete from the women's bicycle team, national team in Germany. And she had an accident and came after 3 years. And she reacted in just 1 year with such an increase of the muscle bulk. And we didn't find any sign of reinnervation because it was somehow unexplainable for us. So this is one of the many questions where we have no solution yet, but it seems that if the muscle is adapted to professional intensive training for many years, then there must be some systemic influence that changes the reaction to retraining of the muscle. But a lot of question marks.
Professor Martin, understand the protocol. You're placing these leads over the quadriceps only, correct?
Yes, we place them over the quadriceps. These are big surface electrodes.
Yeah.
But the crosstalk to the hamstrings is quite
that's
important.
That's what I'm noticing, because the hamstrings are hypertrophying right along with the quadriceps. So this current is spread nicely to everything in the region, huh?
Yeah, it is an advantage, of course, for the decubitus prophylaxis and for the function. We just need the quadriceps, but the field is so intense that it goes through the entire thigh, and we cannot make the electrodes much smaller because otherwise we get risks of tissue damage on the interface. Yeah, so there's also a calculation how the cross-section area or the muscle mass correlates with torque. You see in the initial calculations, there's nearly no correlation of the size of a thigh versus torque development. But when the muscle is strained, we see this nice linear correlation between size and torque, like it should be.
And when you refer to size in this, you're referring to that area that is orange on the image in the upper right corner?
Yes, that is correct. But we made slices all over the tile that we compared over time, and so we can say that in all these slices we had this gain in the mass. But we were collecting more data than are visible here. This is just the main slice in the middle, but we have more from the entire quadriceps muscle. Ugo Carraro in Padua did most of these muscle assessments, and he shows and quantifies the content of the different tissue components before training and after training, and again for early cases and for later cases. And we see everywhere the same density gain of muscle tissue and reduction of collagen, fat, and connective tissue. So in an overview, we have a gain in the muscle size in the CT scan, we have a gain in the fiber diameter, we have a gain in the torque, and we have also a normalization of the fiber diameter and or muscle size to torque relation. A very important assessment was this muscle fiber conduction velocity setup that Christian Hofer developed for his thesis. And you see that he uses stimulation needles and recording needles in a fixed distance at as far as possible the same muscle bundle. And what you see here is the triggering stimulus, and only in this case where the needle is directly at the excitable membrane, you can use short pulses. And then you have a delay, you have the distance, so you can calculate muscle fiber conduction velocity. And with this double impulse paradigm, you can also monitor recovery after an activity of the muscle fiber. And you see that when you reduce this distance between the two stimuli, the later action potential gets lost, and you are in a refractory window. This is also a parameter, so together with the fiber conduction velocity that tells us about the recovery or the retraining of the membrane conditions. So these are just, again, this cyclist here. She had 1 meter per second when she started stimulation, and the interstimulus interval was 8 milliseconds. And after 1 year, she nearly doubled the fiber conduction velocity and less than half of the window. And here is a normal case also after three years of denervation, but there he had already trained for a year, and you see a similar gain in the conduction velocity and in the reduction in the interstimulus interval. I wanted to share this very old picture. This is from the Padua muscle days in 1985, where Thierry Lomo brought a white study with hundreds of rats with denervation, and then doing tests and recordings in the electrophysiological laboratory. And I don't go in all details, but this is of particular interest. He tested the extrajunctional acetylcholine sensitivity that is not given normally when a muscle is innervated and the synapse is connected. But as soon as there is a denervation, the acetylcholine sensitivity spreads all over the surface of the muscle fiber. And then when you put this muscle in an electrophysiological pass and do stimulation, then immediately and in a short time, this spreading of the acetylcholine sensitivity is reversed. So again, one of these many question marks: how does the systemic reaction cause this? Because the muscle fiber must somehow change to be open for as a reinnervation target for synaptic connections, but as soon as it is activated again, it withdraws this huge target again to the earlier zone of the postsynaptic membrane. So this is for us a very interesting observation, and we have no idea how this functions.
And yeah. We think that this corresponds to locations of the motor end plates.
Yes, this he tested this, and it's absolutely focusing again back to the motor end plate region, but without any connection of the electrodes. The electrodes are just integrally placing an electrical field. So there are a lot of signaling secrets that are not yet uncovered, I think. Yeah, this is what happens inside the muscle cell again. The healthy structure with the healthy triads, then degeneration after 15 months. The contractile proteins are quite dissolved, and also the triads get unusual shapes. And after 2 years of training, it is not perfectly restored, but we have kind of normal triads, and we have near normal protein contractile structures. Another question that needs more attention is recovery. So we saw now that we restore part of the muscle fibers in their structure, but there was also evidence that new fibers are born out of the activity with electrical stimulation. So we have satellite cells here, and in these stainings here, Ugo Carraro used Hoechst staining, which displays embryonic myosin, which is only expressed very short time after new building of myofibers. And he was able to show in animal experiments in the rat and in the human biopsies that there was an increase of this activity in the stimulation group. Yeah, a big question that remains open is, can we trust this electrical stimulation? There's a lot of skepticism that maybe electrical stimulation could inhibit the terminal sprouting of the reinnervation, or it could somehow even damage the muscle in receiving nerve connections. And these are just examples, and there's more and more of positive literature on this, and there's also contradictory literature, of course, but Tessa Gordon is pioneering this a lot because she worked a lot in animal experiments and human biopsies. And just recently, the group in Jena, which is specialized on facial reconstructive surgery, they made a huge retrospective study where they had stimulated and reanalyzed the data, and they found that overall there is no change in the rate of reinnervation. There is no change in the time of reinnervation, and what they statistically significantly noticed is that there is less synkinesia in the stimulated group versus the non-stimulated group. The methodology is a little bit suboptimal to apply because the equipment is not yet optimal for the face, but at least it says that there's no damage, and it says that there are positive effects.
Yeah, this can't be the same type of current that you're doing in the quadriceps, because otherwise this would be terribly painful.
Say again.
Where you stimulate the face?
Yeah. Yeah, I come to this. There are parameters that you can use that it is not that there is not much discomfort for the patient. So coming briefly to the parameters, the classical parameters are on the left side: nerve stimulation, that is the established one. Muscle stimulation, has the main difference that you need longer pulses. All other parameters, frequency, fusion frequency, or other changes that are induced by frequency changes are the same. The amplitude ranges are the same. So this doesn't mean we need for all applications such high currents, but this is the range. And if we have an implantable solution, which is still seldom for muscle stimulation, we can go down by a factor of 10. But what really matters is the pulse width. And in this cartoon here, you see already there is a problem with the periodic repetition of pulses because they fill already the entire gap from one pulse to another. And so the frequency is limited that you can accomplish. You need a certain repetition window to achieve higher frequencies. I can do this more. Yeah, classical physiotherapy applied exponential current. So they were in the right direction. They had already long impulses, but the dose of these applications was by far too low, as we know meanwhile. And if you compare it with our protocols, in the meantime, we have 60-fold more stimuli per day to get some muscle growth and recovery. What you addressed before is sensory discomfort. And this is also an old picture of the triangle impulse that has the special advantage that due to an effect we call accommodation, which is where the edge is slow enough to let the diffusion currents in the membrane always maintain equilibrium, which is given for a denervated muscle fiber, but not for a nerve. And so in a certain range of pulse lengths, we have a lower threshold for denervated muscles than for nerves. This has an advantage for sensible discomfort, but also if neighboring muscles are still innervated, if nerves pass by that we want not to involve, then we can use this kind of impulse. There's only a part, there is a high DC component in this classic triangular pulses that are a safety risk. And nowadays we use biphasic ramp impulses that are safer because you can have charge balance and reduce this risk.
Is there no sensory experience with this? They don't perceive anything?
No, it is not a switching off of the sensory experience, and it works less pronounced when you have shorter pulses, relatively shorter pulses, so below 100 milliseconds, the effect gets less. But you can go to a higher activation of the muscles without co-activating the nerves. And the sensations are more bearable.
So there is some kind of a paresthesia, something that they detect, but it's not painful is the idea, is that right?
Yeah. So for the face, for example, it's a problem so far. And also if you have innervated hamstrings, for example, and want just the denervated part activated, then you can somehow find a balance on this. Yeah, the problem I mentioned already is reaching the diffused contraction out of single twitches. With such long pulses, you can only deliver single twitches, but they have a value because they condition the membrane and the excitability of the membrane. So the ion channels in these membranes are changing intensity and type. And so you see in relatively short times, we speak of weeks, you see an increased excitability. You can go to shorter pulses, and when both pulses are short enough to have a repetition frequency in the range of 20-25 milliseconds, then you have a tetanus that you can also use for classical muscle training. So this is a recipe Helmut Kern has developed for the clinic and published. In essence, it's just long pulse single twitches at the beginning, then a little shorter pulse single twitches later. Then you accomplish short enough excited impulses that you can fuse a contraction, and then you can build up muscles. And in a final phase, the best accomplishment is that the patients are able to stand up and do ambulation and stand up trials. There is some safety issue to be considered if you stimulate with high amounts of charge across an interface in the organism, then you deal with an interface between a technical conductor where electrons are conducting and an ion conductor, which the body is. And so you have always electrochemistry involved. So there are measures in the stimulators that disconnect the leads from direct current, which is essential, but you also need to be careful with the amount of charge that you deliver per pulse. The charge is amplitude times time, and so you can calculate it. And there is a safe range till a charge injection limit where all charge and recharge without residual effects in the electrochemistry. But if you exceed the charge injection limits, you get in trouble. And when you, for example, have a high current density on the edge of an electrode, something like this can happen, and this should be avoided by careful handling. So we have mainly for the big muscles, we have these large electrodes with gel or water contact, less these hydrogel electrodes because they have a high inherent resistance. And we have developed these safe electrodes that have a non-conductive lid that makes unloading of the tissue edges where most of the burns are occurring. So I don't get into detail, but you can imagine that here you can easily cause a high current density by just fixing the electrodes. The media can dry out and you can get higher current densities locally. And so these are things to be avoided. At the end, this method, we have a nice tool in clinics where we already know that skin condition is improved, that muscle cushioning is improved, that there's a reduced risk of pressure sore. So patients like the more normal looking extremities. And if patients can stand up, like this gentleman here, then they have an excellent cardiovascular fitness training. And they also load their bones. So it's also osteoporosis prophylaxis. When you compare it with other lesions and ambulatory therapeutic work, then it's pretty similar in all the cases. So here we have the more actual epidural stimulation cases. There we have older neuromuscular stimulation in these two. And this is the example of a flaccid paraplegia and stimulation of denervated quadriceps. So more or less, we can all gain precious activity that is health relevant.
Now, can I ask about this? Yeah? These videos. The stimulation isn't generating enough strength to bear weight. He's locking in the extended position to bear weight.
The connection was not so.
Sure. In order for them to bear weight on this leg, it's not because the stimulation is so strong. It's because it's locking his knees in order to keep the knees from buckling. Is that correct?
Yeah, it is locking the knees left and right. And in this case, with the cardiac vein, you just need the quadriceps. And you need to do all movement of the free leg with the back muscles. In this classical application with neuromuscular, you have quadriceps activated, gluteus activated, and the peroneal reflex for the free movement. And here you have the spinal cord stimulation on the with the epineural electrodes.
Okay.
Yeah, and to give them more fun, we have also a bicycle for denervated muscle, which is not pedaling because it's quite challenging to get a pedaling movement with just denervated muscles and lack of antagonists. But in this case, the seat is moving, is pulling the chain, and the patient just triggers the knee extension. And so he can quite nicely move. Yeah, there are many more applications ahead, I think, and this is also meant to encourage you to think where it could be useful for you. So we have Cauda Equina, of course, that was our main start, but plexus lesions with their long innervation times after nerve repair or cross reinnervation. Facial paralysis with long-lasting reinnervation, larynx applications, recurrent nerve lesions, they all could take advantage of this method. And of course, there are electrode placements that are quite tricky when you think about the shoulder. To have reliably placed electrodes is not so simple. We also have examples where we stimulate the hand muscles to keep the muscle bulk between skin and bone. And in the neck region, there are solutions that are also offered. And in the face, we have these surface electrodes. They are small enough and the currents are small enough to use hydrogel electrodes again, which of course are much better in the face, but there are nearly no devices on the market. This example, the Parese stim, can deliver the right pulses, but with too long intervals. So most of devices are that way, and they are useful for conditioning the muscle excitability, but they are not useful for building muscles. If I have a little time more, I have a recipe how we address the stimulation when we have a paralyzed muscle and expect that it is denervated. What was already mentioned, start early, was on the first year, is a big advantage. Electrode placement is important. We need to cover the target area because we have not the multiplication of a motor unit innervating a group of muscle fibers, but we need to elicit action potentials on each single muscle fiber. At the beginning, we do an excitability and of course, excitability test. And of course, we start with nerve parameters. So first we test, is there part of the muscle or the entire muscle still nerve supplied? And we can test this simply by just applying 1 millisecond impulses or shorter. If there is no reaction, we go on to a test with longer pulses. If there is a reaction, we can consider normal neuromuscular training and hope for additional reinnervation with time. When we do excitability tests with long pulses, we use either triggered single pulses or low frequency, 1 hertz or below. And in case of a pain sensation or unwanted co-contraction, we go to triangular pulses, otherwise we use rectangular. So depending on how long the innervation is back, we start with longer pulses or shorter pulses just to test how strong can the muscle twitch after one pulse. And when we have this, we go gradually lower with the impulse width and look how low can we go before the twitching is collapsing. So below a certain threshold, we don't get a substantial twitch. Then we have a basic parameter, the shortest possible pulse for efficient training. And this is important for safety reasons because we have the least charge transfer, and it also helps us to follow how the membrane excitability is developing. And then we encourage the patient to do this every day at home, to do training sessions with single twitches. And what we already test in the clinic, and he is advised to do this at home all the time, is to carefully look after fatigue. So we have repeated single twitches. If the twitch becomes weaker, we stop a session, and this is our training duration for the moment. And then after a week, we can retest, and maybe the endurance has increased. In checkups, we do excitability tests again and adapt the impulse lengths to lower pulse width continuously. And when we are in the range of 15-20 milliseconds, we are on the safe track to come to a fused tetanus. The training that is recommended is about 30 minutes per day and muscle group 5 times a week. So recovery is also important in the building of muscles. We had animal experiments where we extensively increased the daily dose of stimulation, but we noticed that beyond 30 minutes, there is nothing to gain. But on the other hand, we had animals with continuous stimulation all day. They had no better training result, but also they had no muscle damage. So it was in two directions, a positive result. Yeah, this is also something I want to share. What we very often see is that we have these mixed lesions. Part of the muscle is innervated, part of the muscle is not innervated. We saw this gentleman 5 years after his injury, and he did some electrotherapy, but very unspecific in the past 5 years. And we did first stimulation with nerve parameters, 1 millisecond per phase, 30 hertz, and you see that he has strong wrist flexors. And then we switched with the same electron arrangement to long ramp impulses. And there you see that the wrist is nearly unaffected, but you see mild flexion movements in the fingers. So of course, this could be more if he would have started earlier, but now he's slowly building up muscles again that have been neglected for too long time. And on the extensor side, it is a little bit similar. We see with nerve stimulation, we have a nice wrist extension. And with the, And with the long duration pulses and ramp, we should we see that something is moving there. Yes, that especially the thumb, but also some fingers do mild extension movements. And this is also a nice example that shows that this accommodation effect affects less the innervation of the wrist functions versus activation of muscles that are acting on the fingers.
So in the second video, Winfried, we're seeing that the denervated muscles activate more than the innervated muscles. Is that right? In the first one, we're seeing the muscles that have axons, and the second one, we're seeing movement of the muscles that have no axons within them.
No, we have here also the wrist movements, the flexion and the extension are much stronger because the muscles are innervated. And the fingers are innervated to a very, very low extent. You see, if you look on it carefully, you see some finger movements also. But if you mask out the nerve reaction, then you see that still these few fibers that you reach can do some finger movements, especially on the tongue.
But in the second one, we are specifically avoiding the activation of muscles that are healthy and innervated. Is that correct?
Yeah. On the right side in both cases, yes.
So based on this duration, you select exactly what you're going to stimulate. So you can select away from the nerve to the muscle, select away from the muscle to the nerve.
Yeah. This is what I wanted to show here because this it is for sure no problem to train the wrist function, but then all the other the tiny muscles are neglected that are acting on the fingers, and it's of course precious to build up these muscles. And maybe it's also relevant if some re-innovation is planned.
It's a fascinating concept. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, it's a tool. I think the clinical questions must somehow consider where it could be useful. Yeah, this is just what we need for this intervention. I mentioned already these small stimulators. There are more on the market that can do the can deliver the right pulses, at least for small muscles. They are always limited with about 80 milliamps, and for a quadriceps, for example, this is not useful. But in the face or for the hand, it is useful.
But they will deliver the pulse widths you're discussing.
Yeah, they are delivering the pulse width, but the shortcoming is that they have a certain minimal distance between two impulses. This has some historic reasons on the regulations, and we were the first who got a certified device with shorter pulses because of the clinical study where we could show the data. But all the others that are on the market quite some time, they are limited in intensity and they are limited in the distance of the impulses, which means the frequency. So they can do conditioning of muscle excitability for small muscles. For this, they are good, but for all other applications, they are too limited. And this is the only device that is on the market, and this came out of our RISE project. This can deliver very strong pulses for big muscles, and it can also provide these short gaps between the pulses that are essential for a fused contraction. As a summary at the end, we have evidence that denervated muscles can be maintained in their function and anatomy and metabolic state even in the long term if we start early enough, at least. And so it can be applied for flaccid paraplegia to prevent pressure sores with tissue health and unloading of the problem zones, functional loading of the skeleton for prevention of osteoporosis, functional cardiovascular training, which is all non-invasive and no alternative inside so far. Further, we have evidence that for peripheral nerve injury, we can maintain muscles as a re-innervation target. So we could start early with stimulation, then maybe the surgery is planned, and then there's a little interruption of the stimulation, but after a first healing, we can go on with the stimulation and maintain distant muscles till a nerve arrives in recovering nerves or after surgical repair. And then not to underestimate in a long-term perspective that we can maintain physiological conditions for future accomplishments, because patients that lose all their muscle tissue have no chance if something better is coming, let's say stem cells, miracles or whatever might come, then if they have lost their tissue, they cannot participate, but they can maintain what they have with relatively simple application of stimulation. Yeah, so a lot is to do in research, of course. A lot has come out that we do not know and where we need to learn more with all these systemic influences, with all these metabolic influences, influence on re-innervation characteristic. And then I think the field is open for many applications with plexus lesions, facial, laryngeal, swallow reflex. We have a nice application and a lot more, but we need to understand the systemic interaction. We need strategies for mixed lesions. We need also to see how we can interact with complementary interventions like biological, pharmacological, surgical. So a lot is open to do, and I'm now freshly retired, but I hope there's some time I can still participate in these nice developments. Yes, so then I'm at the end of my talk. I have a little overview of a few of the many people that have contributed yet to this work. We are especially happy to have Professor Dimitrievich as a mentor since many years. He's frequently seeing us and helping us, and with electronic means or also with his presence in Vienna. We have Professor Crevena, who has now an official outpatient clinic for the spinal cord injury syndrome, where we can proceed with all this work in clinical environment, which is essential. And we have a lot of medical and technical colleagues, and not to forget Frank Rattay, a very well-known pioneer in modeling of physiology of stimulation, and Matthias Klein, that you know already. So a lot to do, and a lot of work to be done by still too few people, but I guess you will extend the activist group. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. This is really some of the best work that I've ever seen on this subject, and it raises so many questions when I hear you talk about this. You cited Tessa Gordon earlier, and we still have a hotly debated topic that you would think that we would understand by now, but we don't understand. And that is, why do muscles not recover when we repair nerves late? And if you ask Tessa Gordon, she would say it's because the axons never arrive at the muscle. If you ask the average surgeon at the conferences, they say it's because the motor end plates go away. And then, of course, the other contingent is the muscle atrophies or fibrosis too much to recover recover if an axon reaches it. But the work that you've already shown sort of flies in the face of all of this. You're showing that you can recover a muscle with electrical stimulation several years out. So clearly the muscle is recoverable. You suggest that the motor end plates distribute in a different way. They can come back. So clearly it's not the fault of the motor end plate. This is a very intriguing set of studies, because it opens up the possibility. If you can make a muscle come back to some level of health after 2 years, after 3 years, looks like you're doing it after 4 years, does that open up our window for nerve regeneration down the line? And if the axons can make it to the muscle, that would be very exciting for all of us. We all have patients that come just a little bit too late. Mm-hmm. We have Anil. Is Anil Bhatia still on here? Yeah, Anil Bhatia is with us, and he probably has one of the busiest brachial plexus practices in the world. He has thousands mm-hmm. of patients he's been operating on, and I know this is of interest to him as well. But another question is for you. So anytime our patients get surgery, they go off to a therapist, and the therapist will say, would it be okay if I use my MP, peripheral nerve stimulator, neuromuscular stimulator on the patient to help his recovery? And my short answer is, I don't think it's going to help anything, because these are not the parameters that Dr. Meyer would recommend. What could you talk to address that quickly? Is there any benefit of a typical neuromuscular stimulator on an innervated muscle?
Yeah, I would not say no, because there can always be processes towards renovation. You need to see the more integral picture, what nerves are still there. And I think in this respect, there can always be something, but if there is a completely denervated muscle and there's no reaction on this stimulation, then I wouldn't expect anything to come up. So you need long duration pulses. And if nothing else is available, I would at least have this simple single twitch conditioning, at least for some time. The problem is this one stimulator that is available is only certified in Europe. And this is from a family enterprise, so they cannot afford to certify it with FDA. And they have clients that come from America, get a training, stay a week in Vienna, and buy it and take it home. But to have it in an institution, I think you have strict rules. And I don't know if there's any work around for research, but this would be important to have. There are stimulators that could bridge this a little. These are for example from BioPack. There's a general purpose end stage that you can control with a computer that has an FDA, as far as I know, but Matthias can help you more in this.
I think it would be no problem to get a research protocol with a review board with an IRB in place and use this. I just would have to have a research consent to do what I couldn't do.
Yeah, I think this there are a lot of data available to support that it is applicable in a safe way and beneficial way. So I think that this could be there could be an option to do this, but for a company of this small size, it's over the distance, unrealistic. Yeah.
So the burning question for all the peripheral nerve people in the room is that if you take this 1 year denervated muscle and you stimulate it for 1 year, so at the second year you have this beautiful muscle that you showed pictures of, has anybody done the study that at that point can we reinnervate? And I've seen the facial nerve, it looked like it was on the time schedule that we would expect a successful recovery, and it looked similar to nerve repairs, maybe a little advantage. But these late outcomes, if you've stimulated and helped a very healthy muscle, it's at year number two, year number three, then can we reinnervate it? And I don't see that that's been done. Has it been done?
So this was a question to me now.
Yes, that's a question to you. Yeah. Has it been done that you've preserved a muscle till the second or third year and then repaired the nerve to recover the muscle by reinnervation?
In detail, I don't know, but Werner Kirsch, for example, from our group, he normally does peripheral stimulation when he has done a nerve repair and expect longer innovation time. And in this facial clinic in Jena, they have the problem that sometimes they need to wait if there was a tumor problem for the reason for the surgical intervention, then they need to wait 1 or 2 years till they can start with some reconstructive activities, and they have cases, I'm sure, but I think they could share with us that where they started later with the intervention. I think a lot of potential should be in the plexus brachialis because they have this long waiting times, and then they do muscle flap transfer to get actuators in the periphery. But if you keep them there, then it's a much better chance to have the reinnervation persisting. And I think clinically we need a lot of input from the specialists, of course, but from my perspective of just handling equipment for maintenance of muscle tissue, it should work.
That's very exciting. Well, we are very eager to pursue that here, and hoping that Matthias can help us, and maybe you could consult and give us some guidance from a distance. But I think it's still a very exciting area, and I don't see that other groups have matched the work that you've done yet. So thank you very much for your time this morning. It's really been an honor to have you join us, and I hope we can keep in touch and continue to work on this together.
Yes, I hope also. We will have next year again a Vienna International Workshop on FES, so in the September. So it's maybe another pandemic situation, and if traveling is already possible, we will also have courses on this subject, and of course colleagues that will report on practical outcome.
Perfect. Well, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you. It was a pleasure to meet.